prepared, no?
Yeah, put it on play. Play and record, the two of them, the red and the play. You got them? They both stay down.
It's not moving. The battery?
Huh?
It's not going.
Here, give it to me.
I'm not going to move the car until you sit down.
Yeah, you gotta get paws off.
These trolleys will go along at a blinding 12 miles an hour. And occasionally we can't go on.
Here, you have to get a picture of me. All you gotta do is press that red button.
Uh-huh.
Sight in. And press the red button. You gotta press the stop. I hope I pressed the stop. I don't know if they even got anything before.
Take pictures of the right of way.
All right, why don't I do that? This is going into a documentary from the turn of the century.
Oh, yeah?
Yep. If I can keep those cars out of the thing. You know, might as well. Right here, we'll slow down. In fact, stop if you can. Just pull over this side. Pull up ahead a little more. I got a pole in my way. Tuck?
What?
Can you pull to the curb up a little ahead? Because I got a pole in my way, what I want. All right, good, good.
Okay.
Oh shit, the green one's on.
Thank you.
about your industrial...
You probably did.
Because the boat was in there, I couldn't see. And she's there. 1852.
Peter Dwyer. And I'd like to tell you about a street I grew up on. A street in Kingston with some very fine homes and some historic people that lived there. Some of the widows and widowers were still there as I was a child. I was born to this street in 1932, so my earliest recollections are about 1937. And I prepared a few pages of notes to help me about who some of the famous people were that lived on that street prior to my time. A portion of West Chestnut Street is nationally registered as a historic district. Since the fast-growing village of Roundout was located on a gradual hillside, it was only natural that the top of the hill would seem like the best place to live. So beginning about 1855, many of the leading citizens of Roundout began moving up the hill. From West Chestnut Street, you could look down on the rest of Roundout below and have an additional perspective of the Hudson River, which was much more crowded with river barges and boats than it is today. And to the west, you could see the outline of the Catskills. You also had the advantage, as many other 19th century suburbs before the automobile, being close enough to business to walk to work. And in fact, Samuel D. Kirkendall and his sons made a habit of walking down to work, but were liveried back by servants who were waiting to drive them back up the hill. The hill on which West Chestnut Street is built was farm or pasture land until about the 1850s. Since the early days, a trail or a road, now Broadway, threw a notch in the hill and connected the farming village of Kingston with the boat landing off the Hudson on the Roundout Creek. Before the canal, the Hudson River sloops made the deliveries and the pickup of goods at a boat landing on Abraham Hasbrook's farm, where he conducted a freight business. In 1825, work began on the Delaware and Hudson, a project to bring Pennsylvania coal out to the Hudson and from there up to Canada and down to New York City. The canal entered the Roundout Creek at Eddyville on the eastern end, a few miles upstream from Roundout. The canal company bought the property from the Hasbrooks and other local farmers near Kingston Landing and renamed it Bolton Landing for the canal company's first president. When the canal opened in 1828, Bolton's Landing had only a handful of buildings and a population of about 100. In the 1830s, Bolton Landing grew rapidly. The canal company made Roundout its headquarters, and the availability of the canal and river transportation encouraged new industries that could be served the building boom of New York City and elsewhere. A natural limestone that made a hard-setting concrete was discovered along the banks of the Roundout. Bluestone was quarried for curbstones and sidewalks that New York City was putting in. The clay along the Hudson was workable for bricks, and in the winter, ice was cut from the river and stored in warehouses, then to be shipped south in the summer. Barges were built in the Roundout to haul coal, limestone, bluestone, and brick, and the ice up and down the river. Probably the wealthiest man in Roundout was Thomas Cornell, who built the business of towing these barges on the Hudson. As Roundout grew, other companies based their passenger steamboat service in Roundout, providing day and night boat service between Roundout and New York City. In 1850, the hillside that had been farmland in 1825 was crowded with industry and commercial buildings, and the house and had a population of about 10,000 of newly arrived Irish and German immigrants. In the 1840s, James S. McEntee, the Delaware and Hudson Canal Company superintendent at Roundout, bought 52 acres of land at the top of the hill overlooking the Roundout. McEntee, who had worked as a surveyor for both the Erie and the Delaware and Hudson Canal, built the large island dock in the middle of the Roundout, where coal was offloaded from canal boats to awaiting shipping down the Hudson, and claimed to have suggested the name Roundout as a name for the village. By 1853, McEntee had laid out a street on top of the hill, although not yet identified by name. 5 years later, what the Chestnut Street was named, and four houses were on it, one of those which was James McEntee's. The McEntees had an interesting family, which included Jervis McEntee, who studied with Frederick E. Church and established a reputation as a landscape artist of some note. A daughter, Sarah, was a physician who in later years carried out a practice of gynecology from the McEntee home. And Mary, who married Calvert Law, it was a well-known New York City architect. And Gerard, who built a house across the street, established a local insurance business. Calvert Law, as described in the book Villas and Cottages, an artist studio built for Jervis McEntee that was probably on the McEntee family property. Of the McEntee houses, only Gerard's house still exists. Among the other early residents of the street were Henry Sampson, who built a successful leather tanning business at Sampsonville further west and retired to Roundup, and a Dr. Abraham Crispell, who carried on a long and successful medical practice in Roundup. Like some other houses in the West Chestnut Street area, Dr. Crispell's house would be pictured in Beer's Company's Ulster County Atlas of 1875. Dr. Abram Chalk, who practiced a homeopathic medicine from his home on West Chestnut Street, and William Hutton, George Washburn, Charles Schultz, Frank Van Duzer, were all brick manufacturers. Peter Phillips was with the Delaware Hudson Boatyard Superintendent. John Larder was the company paymaster. James L. Van Duzer, who with his brother was the largest wholesale druggist in the area. Frank Griffin, who ran a flower feed and limestone business. Absalom Anderson, captain of the Mary Powell and owner of the Mary Powell, was one of the best known residents, although his son Absalom Elting Anderson, then the purser on the boat, may have lived longer on the street than he did. Another well-known resident was Dr. David Kennedy, whose patent remedy was sold nationally, and he also was mayor for a time. With the demise of Thomas Cornell in 1890, Sam D. Kirkendall, who had married Mary Cornell, took control of the Thomas Cornell transportation empire, bought a large lot next to James McEntee, and proceeded to build the most imposing house in Kingston, a red brick and stone mansion with a path through the garden down the hill by which he and his sons walked to work. A block down, block west on Augusta Street, Kirkendall built two carriage houses and an adjoining house for his chief stableman. Sam's brother George, who managed the city trolley line, built a somewhat similar but smaller house across the street from his brothers in a similar red brick. Although Sam Kirkendall's house was torn down in 1950, George Kirkendall's house and the carriage houses remain. Another very large house down the street was built by a George J. Smith and later occupied by John D. Schoomaker Sr. Mr. Smith owned a cigar factory in Kingston and employed over 1,000 workers, mostly women, whose he also served in Congress as a Republican congressman for some time. On the other side of the street of the McEntee house, there were some other notable houses. Further down the street, you have a house, one of the last fine houses built on the street was one built for Edward Kirkendall, Sam's son, who had taken over president of the Ulster and Delaware Railroad from his father's estate, and he built a handsome formal villa-style house next to the Smith House. In 1919, Robert J. Dwyer, my own ancestors, purchased the Crispell House and put a very large imposing addition on it in an Italian villa style. In 1922, my grandfather, James F. Dwyer, purchased the James Van Duzer House. And in about 1910, John Hildebrand, who was president and owner of the Hildebrand Dry Dock Company in Conley, and built a very lovely home on the mountainside of this street. In the 1930s, Thomas Feeney, a boat builder, moved to the street. But the automobile and the changing transportation modes put the Delaware and Hudson Canal out of business by 1900, and Portland Cement made the cement around Roundout and the Bluestone non-competitive shortly thereafter. And the economic decline of Roundout was quicker than the rise in the change of fortunes of many who lived on the street. Today, not one of the original families can be found on West Chestnut Street, although a few houses continued to have live-in servants up through the 1940s. Two of the larger houses have been converted into apartment houses. Although local zoning has limited this trend, the Smith House, which is the former Schoemaker House, is such a multiple dwelling unit today, but has been allowed to deteriorate. West Chestnut Street as an area is significant as an example of a late 19th century neighborhood of the wealthy and moderately well-to-do along the Hudson River, and exhibits architectural styles of the 1870s to the 1920 period. It is also generally a well-preserved reminder of a significant community that has largely disappeared. The houses provide at least a strong suggestion of the times and the industries that built them, and most are worth preserving individually as well as a neighborhood. And finally, West Chestnut Street has a district of homes of people whose names are part of the local and state history, such as Jervis McEntee, Epslaw Anderson. Oh, I get a green light now. Now I get some.
Right. Maybe it was plugged in on the way.
And I don't have time now. Thank God, I'm really getting fucking excited.
So you can see through it now?
Yeah. I borrowed a hat like that from the Sears Roebuck yesterday, so I could get on and off the Derby. Because they didn't know what the hell I was borrowing for. I'm a historian and lecturer. Yeah. All right.
Thank you. starting last night, though.
Thank you.
Auto red bun. Thank you for up there.
Thank you.
Yeah, I got her.
All right,
good. Rent it for the weekend.
You rent it?
Yeah. Oh, you still got to run
what
it.
What do you have to do to rent it?
Thank you. My name is Al, and I'll be narrating this 5.5 mile, 35-minute steam train ride for you. Known as the Hutwitz, 1,800 acres large, 400 acres of which are reservoir, and over 210 acres of cranberry bogs, and you'll be seeing lots of boats before this trip is over. Now, as we start out, as I do with every trip, I do ask that all passengers please remain seated at all times, whether you're youngster or old or alike. We are traveling on the narrow gauge rail. We're going to have lots of movement from side to side and back and forth. If you're standing and you don't expect it, it doesn't take much to get bumped around. So the safest place indeed is sitting down. Standing on the steps or the platforms of the cars or walking from one coach to another while the train is moving, it is not permitted. If you are in the caboose, please remain inside at all times and seated. Few folks in the open cars, especially with the children. Please do not allow them to stand on the benches or at the side rail, nor should they lean out or reach over at any time. You can see why if you look out to the side momentarily. Few folks in the cars up front and the closed coaches. Those are very old cars dating back 100 years. We ask your cooperation in maintaining their originality and their antiquity by not putting them. And that war, back in the earliest days of our country, was known as Bog War. It was a very 14th grade of war, but it was all that the colonists had. They extracted it from the earth, converted it to iron to produce the earliest pots, pans, kettles, stoves, food or beverages you purchased at the snack shack. Now, if you are planning to get off, I ask you not to come out on the platforms of the cars, but rather remain seated until we have come to a complete stop at the park. Then you may exit at 10 past 12. If you wish to stay longer, you may. If you are not planning to stay at the park, please do not leave the train, and this will avoid any unnecessary delay in the continuance of our trip. It's a beautiful spot out here. I not only suggest you get off, I highly recommend it. The kids will love you for it. The hour goes very quickly. And again, if you wish to stay longer, you certainly may. Please make use of the transit and please be careful disposing of smoking material. Cranberry Lake Park coming up on your left. Off to the left, those strings. The only things you pay for once you come in are food, beverages, gifts, and souvenirs. Now,
As we move through the month of September and the cooler temperatures return, the berries will begin to reach their maturity. We'll have a beautiful coat of cranberry color, indicating they are indeed ready for harvesting. That harvest begins later in September, goes right through the end of October. In about 5 or 6 weeks, they will take approximately 3 million pounds of berries from this plantation. And all of those berries go over to Ocean Spray in Middleborough, Massachusetts. We are now coming into the village of Beastdale, a typical New England village. Other delicious cranberry products. On your left is the largest single log. The cranberry can trace its importance all the way back to the first Thanksgiving in 1621. That is when it was up there, resembled the head of a crane. Explain what is happening. It's an exciting experience. Nothing quite like the sight of a flooded thing and innovative going on here at Edaville. So come on to back and join in the fun, the excitement. Have a wonderful holiday. Enjoy the rest of your day with us here at Edaville. Next stop is the Edaville Depot. Thank you.
light. We will be tying up here in just a few moments. This time I would like to request everybody to please find a seat. And please remain seated until the vessel is safely tied to the dock and the gangway has been set. This matter, Bud, Jim, and I won't be stepping on any toes as we scurry around to tie off the vessel or set the gangway. Also, please be sure if you are in the starboard or right side of the vessel that you and your children do keep all your hands, head, legs, arms, anything like that you figure you might want to use again inside the vessel as we approach the dock.
Thank you. yeah, but the line shouldn't have changed.
No, the line shouldn't
have changed.
No.
Okay, take care of it.
Thank you.
is it. Mm-hmm.